Good morning and welcome to our online service from Lakeside Community Church in Salmon Arm, BC. Great to have you join us this morning or whatever time of the day or week that you are watching this. My name is Ken Dryden, I'm pastor here at Lakeside Church. And we are so happy to be able to have you join this morning. We pray that the service this morning will be an encouragement to you. I want to let you know that if you have a prayer request or a question that you would like to ask, please send that along to us. Our contact information will be on the screen later in the service. So telephone number, email address, our website address for more information on Lakeside. Please check those out and keep in touch with us if you have any concerns or questions, or if you'd like us to pray with and for you. If you want to partner with us financially, that information will also be on the screen. A couple of things that I want to mention as we start off this morning. As churches are all over the world, we're gradually opening up, not only business-wise, but churches are opening up as well and finding ways to meet together during this pandemic in ways that are safe and sensitive to different people's needs. And so that's what we're doing as well. So we are continuing on with our online presence for the foreseeable future. But as well, we are, as of today, starting some, what we're calling, for lack of a better term, backyard gatherings. And so they will be outdoors and we'll be observing proper and safe physical distancing and just making sure that we're careful with one another. And just a chance to interact around the teaching of the morning in our online services, a chance to be together in person, which we certainly missed, and pray for one another, encourage one another. So hopefully if you are around Salmon Arm and you would like to be part of one of those backyard gatherings today or in the next number of weeks, that you have received an invitation. If you haven't and you'd like to be part of that, please let us know, contact us, and we'll get in touch with you. If you're not from Salmon Arm and you're watching today, hopefully there's someone that you can connect with today, wherever you are, and have someone to pray with and for you and to interact around some of the things that we're talking about today. You will notice that underneath the, or next to the link to the video for this service this morning, there's also a discussion guide attached that you can download and print if you'd like. And that just gives you some very simple questions to reflect on, a little bit of a summary of the message. And hopefully that's a helpful tool for you, or if you're meeting together with a group, something that you can use together. So welcome to our service this morning, and let's begin with prayer. Father God, we thank you, Lord, for this day that you have made. Father, thank you that you preserve us through the night. Thank you that you give us health and strength and you watch over us. Father, we pray, Lord God, that by your Spirit you would speak to us this morning, wherever we are and whatever we're feeling, whatever challenges we might be facing today, Lord God, that we would find that you are sufficient for every need that we have. We pray, Lord God, by your Spirit, that you would reveal your will to us today, that you would speak to us, that you would lead and guide us. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.
Our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 15, 1-2. Who may worship in your sanctuary, Lord? Who may enter your presence on your holy hill? Those who lead blameless lives and do what is right, speaking the truth from sincere hearts. This is the word of the Lord.
Heaven, you came running. There was mercy in your eyes. throne of endless glory, to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. To reveal the kingdom coming, and to the stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death, and the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who'd come to the Father are restored, and the Church of Christ was born.
Good morning. This is our scripture reading for the morning. It's Acts 1, 1 to 11. In my first book, I told you, Theophilus, about everything Jesus began to do and teach until the day he was taken up to heaven after giving his chosen apostles further instructions through the Holy Spirit. During the 40 days after he suffered and died, he appeared to the apostles from time to time, and he proved to them in many ways that he was actually alive. And he talked to them about the kingdom of God. Once he was eating with them, Jesus commanded them, "Do not leave Jerusalem until the Father sends you the gift he promised, as he told you before. John baptized with water, but just in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." So the apostles were with Jesus. They kept asking him, Lord, has the time come for you to free Israel and to restore our kingdom? Jesus replied, the Father alone has the authority to set those dates and times, and they are not for you to know. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses, telling the people about me everything, everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea, in Samaria, and in the ends of the earth. After saying this, he was taken up into a cloud while they were watching, and they could no longer see him. As they strained to see him rising into heaven, two white-robed men suddenly stood among them. Men of Galilee, they said, why are you standing there staring into heaven? Jesus has been taken from you into heaven, but someday he will return from heaven in the same way you saw him go.
Okay. 10 years from now, I wonder how they will tell the story of 2021. I wonder how they will portray the global pandemic, the racial tensions, the economic challenges, the political upheavals of this time. How will they evaluate our responses to the challenges, politically, socially, spiritually? In hindsight, how will we be looked upon? 10 years from now, will this be seen as a moment in time that has major societal impact and led to big changes and lasting changes, whether good ones or bad ones? Or will it be seen just as kind of a blip on the radar of history? Challenging, but in time we just kind of went back to the way things were. Well, of course, I don't know. I don't claim to be able to predict the future. For many, we're just trying to get through this, figuring it out as we go. In my own life, in the life of this church, I wonder what the long-term impact will be. Will this be one of those hinge moments in time? A hinge moment is a phrase that was invoked by a Princeton physicist by the name of Freeman Dyson to describe a pivot that connects two historical periods in time. And so there would be a time when you point back to the hinge moment and say something like this: before the pandemic and lockdowns of 2020, or before the Black Lives Matters protests in 2020, and then you can point to the definite changes that came after this had taken place. And I wonder, will this make us a more unified and more caring people? Will it bring us together to find solutions for a health crisis and to address issues of racism? Or will we just try to get through this and hope the challenges just go away in time? Will it cause us to take a deeper look at ourselves and at our blind spots and repent of our sins and learn to love our neighbors or even our enemies? Or will we become more entrenched in our positions? Will we listen and learn, or will we remain unchanged? I think about these things quite a bit, and especially when it comes to the church. What will the church look like in the coming years? Are we willing to take a hard look at ourselves and make the changes that are needed? Or do we just continue the decline because we're unwilling to address them? Could this be one of those hinge moments in the life of the church, as well as in our own world, in our world? You know, it's hard to know when you're in the midst of it. The passage we are looking at today is in the book of Acts, chapter 1, was one of the hinge moments in history and in the life of the church. A moment that had and still has life-changing and even world-changing impacts. A couple of weeks ago, we started our series in the book of Acts, and I mentioned that one of the ways that we can understand this book is hinted at in chapter 1 of Acts, verse 1, when the writer of Acts, Luke, describes the Gospel of Luke as the story of everything that Jesus began to do and teach. And the implication is that what we have in Acts is part 2 of the story of everything Jesus began to do and teach. And the even further implication is that because Acts ends kind of abruptly, the story is far from being complete. The implication is the story continues in us and through us. So Lakeside, one of my conclusions was we need to get on our knees and pray that God would write some new chapters in and through us by the power of His Spirit to do a fresh work of God in our lives. Let's pray. Father, I pray that you guide us as we look at your word this morning. Open our eyes and our ears to hear and see what you have for us. In Jesus' name, amen. I wonder if this could be one of those hinge moments in time for us. You know, these followers of Jesus in the book of Acts in chapter 1, just in these last number of days before this happened, were confused and impatient and fearful, and they didn't know what was going on. And Luke didn't know the concept of hinge moment. He wouldn't have used those terms, but I think the way he presents the ascension in the book of Acts and the Gospels paints it that way. If we read the last part, Luke 24, we read this: "Then Jesus led them to Bethany, and lifting his hands to heaven, he blessed them. And while he was blessing them, he left them and was taken up to heaven. So they worshiped him and then returned to Jerusalem filled with great joy. And they spent all their time in the temple praising God." Something dramatic had happened, obviously, and they were transformed. And then we move right on to the beginning of the book of Acts chapter 1, the beginning of the story of the church and the account of the ascension, chapter 1, 9 to 11. "After saying this, he was taken up in a cloud while they were watching, and they could no longer see him. And as they strained to see him rising into heaven, two white-robed men suddenly stood among them and said, 'Men of Galilee, why are you standing there staring into heaven? Jesus has been taken from you into heaven, but someday he will return from heaven in the same way you saw him go.'" He repeats that story of the ascension both at the end of Luke and the beginning of Acts because it's important. It's a big part of the explanation of the transformation of those Christ followers and why they had such confidence and boldness in proclaiming Christ as Lord. Now, we don't talk a lot about the ascension. It's kind of a weird story for us, and we're not sure often what to do with it. But it stands as a hinge moment between the ministry of Jesus, his life, death, and resurrection, and the ministry of Jesus through ordinary men and women empowered by the Holy Spirit in the book of Acts, and actually down through the ages. And I think that there were things in that event that finally solidified in the hearts and minds of those followers of Jesus after the ascension, and prepared for them to be the witnesses to Jesus that he said that they would be. Things we need to understand and believe as well, if we're to be witnesses to him in our world today. Things that Jesus had talked about and demonstrated throughout his time with these disciples, and even during those 40 days between the resurrection and the ascension, he continued to teach them these things. And so we read in the first part of chapter 1 of Acts, "During the 40 days after he suffered and died, he appeared to the apostles from time to time, and he proved to them in many ways that he was actually alive. And he talked to them about the kingdom of God." That's Acts chapter 1, verse 3. They needed to get to the place where they were convinced beyond a shadow of a doubt of who Jesus is and that he is alive and what the nature of the kingdom is and how to live in it. There's no other way that they would be able to persevere as his witnesses from Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and even to the ends of the earth. After all, the root word in the Greek translated as witnesses is the same root word for the word martyr. And those first believers, and many since then, would understand well the significance of that fact. So why did the ascension have such a powerful effect on these disciples? Let me give you five reasons the ascension makes a difference then and now. The first is this: the king rules. When Jesus ascended, his eternal reign over his enemies began. As the Apostle Peter wrote, "Now Christ has gone to heaven. He is seated in the place of honor next to God. And all the angels and authorities and powers accept his authority." That's 1 Peter 3, verse 22. That's why the Bible pictures the ascension as Jesus going up into heaven, leading a host of captives. That's Ephesians chapter 4, verse 8. The defeated enemies of the kingdom. And arriving in heaven, he sits down at the Father's right hand. And we read that in Psalm 110 and verse 1 and Hebrews verse, chapter 1, verse 3. His rule has begun. The kingdom is here. With his birth, the king arrives. With his life, death, and resurrection, the king redeems. With his ascension, the king rules. The first disciples would have recognized the significance of a king who is taken up in a cloud and will return in clouds. It's apocalyptic language, like the language that we have in the book of Revelation. And it goes back to the book of Daniel in chapter 7, where we could read about one like a son of man. He's oppressed and he's attacked and he suffers at the hands of wild beasts from the sea. Powers, whether political or spiritual, but he eventually triumphs and is now exalted on his throne. All of his enemies have been put in their place. And the ascension shows that Jesus is now enthroned as king. And so the second point follows from that. The kingdom has come. The disciples ask Jesus before his ascension, "Is now the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel?" And Jesus redirects the question. It's not about times. "My agenda is that you will receive power and be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the very ends of the earth. Yes, the kingdom is coming, but not in the way you think it will. Not in a political, nationalistic, militaristic takeover." It's strange and sad that we still make that mistake. The kingdom coming looks like the church bearing witness to Jesus, like ambassadors carrying the message of the gospel to foreign nations. It means we announce that we have a new king. He is the world's true Lord, and his name is Jesus. Even in the face of oppressive leaders who promote themselves as king and Lord, like the Herods and Caesars of the time, the king's rule is being launched on earth with his ascension. It's being launched on earth as it is in heaven. Jesus asks us to pray that way. So that's the second one. The kingdom comes. And the third one, the intercessory work begins. When Jesus ascended, his intercessory work on our behalf, the behalf of his people, began. 1 John chapter 2, verse 1 says, "We have an advocate who pleads our case before the Father. He is Jesus Christ, the one who is truly righteous." Jesus serves forever as our true high priest. We read that in Hebrews chapter 9. The perfect priest who cleansed the people from their sins and will always represent them before the Father. He is our intercessor in heaven. And the fourth one is the Spirit empowers. When Jesus ascended, the church was empowered to accomplish his mission. Jesus says, "It is to your advantage that I go away," in John chapter 16, verse 5. It's surprising that he would say that. I'm sure that the disciples at the time would have questioned how that could possibly be. How could it be better for us if you go away? When Jesus ascended, the Spirit came and filled his people. The disciples initially were standing there, slack-jawed, looking up into the sky, wondering what had just happened. And the angels asked them, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand there looking up into the sky?" Jesus' ascension does not mean that he is now absent. He continues to be present by the Holy Spirit. It doesn't mean that his mission is over. It's just beginning. Now he will work by his Spirit through his people. And not only that, the Father, by his Spirit, gives gifts to his children, to his people, to carry out his mission. He gives gifts to his children to carry out his mission. It says, "When he ascended on high, he led crowds of captives and he gave gifts to his people." Ephesians chapter 4, verse 8. And the fifth point is the future is bright. The ascension is a powerful reminder of our destiny. You know, when Jesus ascended, he didn't just shed his humanity like a cheap suit. Jesus enters the realm of heaven with a physical body. Granted, one that can no longer be sick or die, get hurt or decay. As hard as this is for us to grasp, there is now one who inhabits heaven with a body like ours. This is our hope. In the ascension, Jesus goes before us. He is the first fruits of those who will be raised from the dead. We will not just be disembodied spirits in heaven. Now, there's much more that we could say about the ascension, but these are certainly things that the disciples learned from the ascension and that changed their lives, that gave them hope and boldness and joy. But it's not just their story. We are living the story. You know, we tend to think of all of these things as in the past tense. Jesus lived, Jesus died, Jesus rose again, Jesus ascended back to heaven. The Holy Spirit came. End of story. But it's not the end. It's the beginning for us. The beginning for the church, the beginning of our witness, the beginning of the faith, the beginning of the good news which would be carried to the ends of the earth to all nations. Jesus is alive, and what's more, he's seated at the right hand of God the Father. But here's where it really gets good. He's left us to represent him. Here in this world, he loves so much that he gave himself for it. And we're not alone. He sent the Holy Spirit to fill us. And he has given us gifts to guide us and to empower us. We are living the story of Jesus in the power of his Spirit for the life of his creation. Jesus continues his work through us. That's what the ascension is all about. It's not just a clever theatrical trick to get Jesus off the stage, but a dramatic theological transition, a hinge moment, a moment that transcends time and space, where heaven received in victory the risen Christ and earth received in gratitude his ever-present Spirit. Now, in conclusion, some moments have the power to define the future. This could be one of them. What will we do with this moment in time? What is God wanting to teach us about himself and about his kingdom? May we seize this moment and live with boldness and confidence, proclaiming that Christ is Lord. Amen. Thanks so much for joining us, our online service this morning from Lakeside Community Church in Salmon Arm, BC. So good to have you join us this morning. Again, if you would like to ask a question or send us a prayer request, please do. The information to contact us will be on the screen in just a moment. If you'd like to partner with us financially, that information is there as well. If you'd like to know more about Lakeside Community Church, our website address will be posted. Please check that out. Great. So great to have you here with us online. Hope you can join us next week. Let me pray with you this morning. Let's pray. Lord God Almighty and Everlasting Father, you have brought us in safety to this new day. Preserve us with your mighty power, that we may not fall into sin nor be overcome by adversity. And in all we do, direct us to the fulfilling of your purpose through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. God bless you. Have a wonderful week.